Well, actually, this is a very difficult question to answer, and to be honest, there is no conclusive answer. The way we need to answer this question is that PGS needs to be offered as an option, definitely, but it needs to be offered as an option after very thorough consultation so that the couple is aware of the existing evidence, which actually is not conclusive. And only after knowing everything about what really PGS offers to egg donation, they can decide if it's worth doing it or not. To be honest with you, chances of success are really good even without PGS if we carefully select the donors to be young, to be between 24 and 30 years old, to have a full karyotype analysis themselves, to know that they do not have a family history of infertility, even to do a fragile X genetic test on them. As good the selection is, the chances can be really good even without PGS. So, if we want to answer the question if PGS does increase the chances or not, the answer is that yes, it does increase the chances, but what it really does is it increases the chances of the initial embryo transfer from the selected embryo through PGS. This means that if, for example, we have four or five blastocysts and we do PGS on all of them, we know that from the initial transfer, if we have managed to find a blastocyst, an embryo that is chromosomically normal, the chances are more with PGS rather than if we hadn't done PGS before. So actually, PGS makes it quicker as well. It makes a live birth happening faster. It reduces the chances of miscarriage, yes, to less than 6%, because we know that if we transfer an embryo that does not have any chromosomal abnormalities, the chances of miscarriage are less than 6%. On the other hand, PGS is a procedure that costs a lot of money. There is evidence that says that even chromosomically not perfect embryos, embryos that have mosaicism, this means normal and abnormal cells together, if we transfer them, they could give a pregnancy. Those are embryos that will not be selected for transfer if we do PGS, but we would transfer them if we hadn't done PGS. Also, PGS causes a trauma to the embryo. Even if we do PGS on day five, that nowadays we know that it gives best results, it can cause a trauma to the embryo, and how exactly this will affect the chances of implantation, we are not sure. So, if we assess and if we calculate actually the total chances, the cumulative chances from fresh and frozen embryos coming from an initial egg collection without PGS, it would be actually equal to the chances of doing PGS, because possibly PGS would have ruled out embryos that we would transfer them if PGS wasn't done. It's a complicated answer generally, and to conclude and to debrief actually, I would say that PGS needs to be advised if, for example, we have sperm problems, severe sperm problems, and a karyotype to the male partner that shows chromosome translocations, abnormalities. On this occasion, PGD needs to be done. Also, if we have previously recurrent failures of implantation with egg donation, or recurrent miscarriages with egg donation, then PGS is recommended to be done. Finally, I would say that if a couple says that I only want a single embryo transfer, this is also an indication for PGS, because if we have a lot of embryos, we can choose the one that is chromosomically normal, and the chances there are much better with PGS. But generally, if we take everything into consideration, the cost and all the other factors, it is a decision in the end that needs to be made by the couple to decide if it's worth doing it or not. If we have a lot of embryos and if we do have a lot of blastocysts, the chances are always better with PGS. If we do not have a lot of blastocysts, maybe PGS will not play an important role, because PGS means selection, and there is no selection if we would transfer two embryos one way or the other.